Penguin Random House Audio presents Firebrand by Kristen Britton. Read for you by Ellen Archer. Arrivals.
I know you can do it. Mara placed her hands on Kerrigan's shoulders and squeezed. But you survived Blackvale and Mournhaven the Black. You've even been through time. I don't know.
Karigan glanced uncertainly toward the open doors of the throne room. The guards posted there watched her with interest.
I know. Mara turned her around and marched her toward the entrance. This had to happen sooner or later, Karigan thought, but still she resisted. Mara just pushed harder until they stood on the threshold.
Now be a good green rider and go on in there, Mara said.
Easy for you to say. Aren't you coming?
Heavens no, you couldn't drag me.
Coward. Karigan knew her friend meant well, but a little more support would not have been asking too much.
Mara simply smiled and gave her a gentle push. Karigan took a shaky breath and stepped across the threshold into the throne room.
Karigan Helgadorf G’ladheon!
It thundered like a pronouncement of doom from the gods, and she pivoted as if to run back the way she had come, but Mara, arms crossed and shaking her head, blocked her escape.
Helgadorf?
Asked an amused voice. King Zachary. Karigan winced, and warmth crept into her cheeks. Mara grinned at her.
Named after her great-grand-aunt, Your Majesty, came a crusty reply. A prickly old banshee no one particularly liked. Why, Stevik would name her after
Brini,
came a sharp warning. Karigan slowly turned back around. There, arrayed before the king's throne, with a frazzled-looking Captain Mapstone in their midst, were her aunts, all four of them, and standing aloof, just off to the side, her father. When Mara had informed her of their arrival, she'd been caught off guard, for they'd sent no forewarning, and it was winter when travel was difficult. Karigan, still struggling to adjust to ordinary life after her all-too-recent adventures, coupled with the accompanying darkness and sorrow, now faced a huge dose of ordinary in the form of her family, and it threatened to overwhelm her. Her aunts could exasperate even the stoutest of souls at the best of times, and she was so very tired.
Helgadorf was more a leader than anyone else on Black Island during her day, Aunt Stace said with a sniff. She organized the island to repel pirates and raids from the Underkingdoms.
She was still a banshee,
Aunt Brini muttered, and then whispered loud enough for all to hear.
And she still is.
Great-grand-aunt Helgadorf had been dead for 40 years. Ignoring her sister, Aunt Stace, with her hands on her hips, said,
Don't just stand there like a post without a fence, Carrie girl. Come here.
Karigan glanced over her shoulder. Mara had not lingered to witness the reunion. She considered making a run for it, but doing so would only prolong the inevitable. Best to face them now. She took a deep breath and started walking slowly down the runner like a swimmer, reluctant to dive into icy water. It wasn't that she didn't want to see her family. She loved them more than anything. But she didn't want to face their questions about the expedition into Blackvale, about how she'd gone missing and was presumed dead. She didn't want to speak of the future and her experiences there, because to do so was to relive the dark. And her memories of Cade? Those were hers, and hers alone, and not a casual topic of conversation. Knowing her aunts, however, they would pick and pry until they stripped the carcass to the bone. When she had written them after her return just over a month ago, she'd been characteristically terse, reassuring them she was alive and well, but avoiding the painful details. Captain Mapstone had also written her father, but she had no idea what had been said. Her aunt's questions would come, she knew, from a place of love and concern, but she was not ready or willing to encourage them with additional fodder. And then there was the subject of her eye, about which she had said nothing and about which they were bound to make an issue. She touched the leather patch that covered it,
her right eye, and took another determined breath and picked up her pace. When she reached her aunt's, they swarmed her with crushing hugs and kisses and complaints.
You are too skinny. We were told you were dead.
Thank the gods you came back to us.
Aunt Greta stared at her critically, her head canted to the side.
What is wrong with your eye?
Got something in it is all, Karigan replied.
Let me see.
Aunt Greta reached for her eye patch. No, Karigan backed away.
I just want to see what's wrong with your eye,
Aunt Greta said in a stung voice. Karigan covered it with her hand. No. Removing the patch, Captain Mapstone said, causes her eye pain. That was very true, but it was so much more than that. Because the captain had spoken up, all four aunts now turned on her, demanding explanations. The captain must have known this would happen, and Karigan made a mental note to thank her at the next opportunity. Her father, who had stood remote, used the distraction to finally reach for her, his arms wide open. She stepped into his embrace and hugged him hard.
We had to come and see you, he murmured. Nothing could stop us. We thought we had lost you.
I know, she said, but I came back. I'm too stubborn to be lost, stubborn like you. When they parted, he rubbed his eyes. Karigan stared, astonished. Had she ever seen him cry before? He took a rattling breath and collected himself.
I would like the complete story of what happened to you. The captain,
and now his voice tightened,
was vague on the subject. And your letter was, shall we say, rather lacking.
At that moment, a hand rested on her sleeve. Startled, she looked up. The king. He had descended from his throne chair and approached from her blind side. She'd never get used to the loss of her peripheral vision in that eye. Your Majesty, she said a little breathlessly. She looked down, unable to meet his gaze, for it held so much that remained unresolved between them.
I believe your captain requires rescuing.
She glanced at her besieged captain. All four aunts were still chivying her about Karigan's appearance, and didn't she take better care of the people under her command? Thankfully, Karigan thought, they could not see her other scars, those of the flesh hidden by her uniform, as well as the invisible wounds within.
Enough! She told them firmly. Captain Mapstone is not to blame for anything.
When this failed to quell their outrage, she added,
And do not forget, you are in the king's presence.
That silenced them, and quite suddenly they each looked ashamed and started curtsying to the king and uttering chastened apologies. Captain Mapstone simply looked relieved.
Sir Karigan, the king said, we are releasing you from duty. So you may spend a couple days with your family. We hope you will be able to satisfy their curiosity about your most recent exploits. And to your family, we say, know that Sir Karigan has our highest esteem. She has served this realm well and courageously time and again. She should receive no reproach from her closest kin, only praise and honor.
Karigan stared at him in surprise. First, he had used the royal we, which she had rarely, if ever, heard from him. Then there was the rest of his speech. Her aunts looked astonished and her father very proud. It wasn't as if they hadn't known the king regarded her highly. He had knighted her, after all. But it must have made more of an impression on them coming directly from his mouth. It certainly impressed Karigan. Her father bowed.
Thank you, sire. I have always considered my daughter exceptional, and it pleases me she has served your majesty well. But we have been enough of a distraction to you, as you must have important matters of state to attend to.
As if his words had been prescient, there was a brief commotion at the throne room entrance, and a moment later, Neff, the herald, bolted down the length of the room and bowed before the king.
Your majesty, visitors from...
He didn't have to complete his sentence for them to know where the visitors were from. Three of them, cloaked in shimmering gray against the winter, entered the throne room. The dim afternoon light seemed to stretch through the tall windows for the singular purpose of brightening.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.